It was the spring of 2020, and the world was in chaos. The pandemic had put a halt to life as everyone knew it. For Ethan and Sarah Clark, however, the disruption presented an opportunity. Ethan, a mid-level manager at a local bank, was offered a transfer to Brooksville, Florida, a quiet town on the outskirts of the state's most rural areas. The transfer couldn't have come at a better time. With their first child, Noah, recently born, they wanted a fresh start. A place where they could raise their child away from the growing fears of the world. Brooksville was exactly what they had hoped for. Known for its southern charm, long stretches of farmland, and a close-knit community, it seemed like the perfect place to escape the madness. The house they were offered through Ethan's work was larger than they ever imagined they could afford. A two-story colonial, with whitewashed walls and dark green shutters, it stood at the edge of the forest, shrouded in the canopy of towering oak trees. The moment they arrived, Sarah was in love. "It's perfect," she said, standing at the entrance, cradling baby Noah in her arms. The front porch had a swing that gently swayed in the breeze, and the wide front lawn stretched out toward the gravel road. But what struck her most was the silence. It was so quiet, so peaceful, as though the chaos of the outside world didn't touch this place. "Yeah, perfect," Ethan replied with a slight hesitation in his voice. There was something unsettling about the house. He couldn't quite put his finger on it. Maybe it was the way the forest crept up to the back of the property, casting long, dark shadows even in the midday sun. But he brushed it off. After all, they were starting fresh, and the house was too good of a deal to pass up. They spent the next week settling in. Ethan had already started his new position at the bank, and Sarah was busy getting the house ready while taking care of Noah. It felt like a dream come true, until the first night. It was well past midnight when Sarah woke up to the sound of something faint. At first, she thought it was the wind, but as she lay still, listening intently, she realized it was coming from Noah's room. The soft, rhythmic creaking of his crib moving. Her heart skipped a beat. Had Noah woken up? She waited for his cries, but none came. She nudged Ethan awake. "Do you hear that?" Ethan, groggy from sleep, mumbled something incoherent before rolling over. Sarah sighed, pulling herself out of bed. She walked quietly to Noah's room, half expecting to find him awake and restless. But when she opened the door, she froze. The crib was rocking slightly, but Noah was fast asleep. The room was dim, with only a sliver of moonlight filtering through the window. There was no wind, no reason for the crib to move. A chill ran down her spine, but she forced herself to approach the crib. She reached out, steadying the cradle. Noah didn't stir, and everything seemed normal again. Maybe it was just her imagination, or perhaps the old house had its creaks and groans. She dismissed it, convincing herself it was nothing, and returned to bed. But the next morning, something even stranger happened. Sarah woke early, the sun barely peeking through the curtains. As she made her way to Noah's room, she noticed something odd. His crib had been moved, again. This time, it wasn't just slightly rocking, it had been dragged across the room, stopping just in front of the bathroom door. She felt a wave of nausea. Had Ethan done this in his sleep? When Ethan finally woke, Sarah confronted him. "Did you move Noah's crib last night?" Ethan blinked at her, clearly confused. "No, I didn't." "Why would I do that?" "Well, someone did," Sarah replied, her voice trembling. She gestured toward the crib, now eerily positioned by the bathroom. "It was over there when I checked on him last night, and now it's here." Ethan rubbed his eyes and shook his head. "I don't know. Maybe I did get up in the middle of the night and don't remember. I was pretty out of it." Sarah wanted to believe him, but something about the whole situation felt wrong. The uneasy feeling gnawed at her, but she pushed it aside. Moving was stressful, and maybe she was just overreacting. 4 days later, the Clarks were starting to settle into a routine. Ethan was getting comfortable at his new job, and Sarah was slowly adjusting to life in Brooksville. But the house, there was something about it that continued to unsettle her. On the fifth night, Sarah woke again. This time, it wasn't the sound of the crib rocking that startled her awake. It was Noah's laughter, soft at first but gradually growing louder. She glanced at the clock, 2 a.m. Her heart pounded in her chest as she got up and walked toward Noah's room. The house was dead silent, except for the sound of Noah giggling. The sound was unnerving in the dark, echoing off the walls in a way that felt unnatural. When she reached the door, she saw something that stopped her in her tracks. The crib, once again, had moved. This time, it was completely pressed against the bathroom door. But that wasn't the worst part. Noah was standing in his crib, facing the bathroom, his tiny face lit with delight as if he were watching someone, as if he were laughing with someone. Sarah's breath caught in her throat. Who was in the bathroom? As she approached, her eyes darted to the bathroom door, which was slightly ajar. A cold draft wafted out, chilling her skin. Noah's laughter echoed in the small room. She reached for him, her fingers trembling, and that's when she saw it. A figure standing in the shadow of the doorway. A tall man, easily over 6 feet, stood just inside the bathroom. His skin was dark, his face obscured by the darkness, but there was something unmistakable about his presence. He was talking softly, in a language Sarah couldn't understand. His words were whispered, but they carried a strange weight, as though they didn't belong in this world. And Noah, he was responding, his laughter filling the room. Sarah let out a gasp and stumbled backward. She couldn't move. Her legs felt frozen, and her mind struggled to process what she was seeing. How could this be real? She turned and ran to wake Ethan. "Ethan, wake up! There's someone in the house!" Ethan bolted upright, his eyes wide with alarm. "What? Who?" "There's a man! He's in Noah's room!" she cried, pulling him out of bed. Together, they rushed back to Noah's room, but when they got there, the figure was gone. Only Noah remained, sitting in his crib, giggling softly. Ethan stared at the empty space in disbelief. "There's no one here, Sarah." But Sarah knew what she had seen. Her heart was still pounding in her chest. No, there was someone. He was right there. I swear it. Without a second thought, Sarah grabbed Noah and insisted they leave. "We can't stay here. We need to go now." Ethan, though skeptical, could see the terror in her eyes. He didn't argue. They packed a few essentials and fled the house that very night, driving to a nearby motel. The next morning, Ethan called the landlord, a man named Roland, and explained the bizarre events. Roland seemed unfazed. "That house has been vacant for a while," he said casually. "But I've never heard of anything like that happening before." Ethan pressed him. "Are you sure? Because something is wrong with that place." Roland hesitated for a moment before admitting. "Well, there have been stories. Some say it's haunted, but I've always chalked it up to rumors. People in town love to spin a good ghost story." But this wasn't just a story for Ethan and Sarah. It was real. Too real. Desperate for answers, Roland suggested they bring in a local priest to cleanse the house. Ethan and Sarah agreed. The priest arrived the next day, a middle-aged man with a calm demeanor. He walked through the house, sprinkling holy water and muttering prayers under his breath. But as he entered the bathroom, the atmosphere shifted. The air grew thick, oppressive, and the priest stopped mid-prayer. His face paled, and he turned to Roland. "I can't help you," he said quietly. "This isn't a haunting. It's something older, something darker. You'll need someone else." Before anyone could ask what he meant, the priest hurried out of the house, refusing to say more. Roland was at a loss. If the priest couldn't help, what could they do? That's when an old friend of Roland's, a spiritual medium named Abigail, stepped in. Abigail was known for her ability to sense the supernatural, and she agreed to visit the house. After spending a few hours inside, she finally revealed the horrifying truth. "This isn't a ghost or a spirit," she said gravely. "What you're dealing with is a jinn, an ancient entity. It has claimed this house as its own. It's not something that can be banished easily. The jinn has been here for years, and it won't leave without a fight." Ethan and Sarah were stunned. A jinn? They had heard stories of such entities, but they never believed they were real. But now, faced with the reality of what they had experienced, there was no denying it. With no other option, Roland decided to seal the house. The doors were locked, the windows boarded up, and the house was left to the jinn. No one in Brooksville dared go near it. For the next 3 years, the house sat empty, a silent reminder of the terror that lurked within. But in 2024, a new family, unaware of the house's dark history, moved in. They knew nothing of the jinn, of the strange occurrences that had driven Ethan and Sarah away. And so, the cycle began again. The jinn waited, biding its time, knowing that soon, it would show itself once more. If you ever find yourself looking for a new home, remember to ask about its history, because the spirits of the past don't always stay quiet. And sometimes, what lurks in the shadows is far more dangerous than a mere ghost.